Good morning and welcome to Macquarie Chapel Presbyterian Church. Wherever you are tuning in from, welcome. It's great to have you with us this morning. And particularly if you are in our local area, you would have known yesterday was a fairly miserable day. This morning is a glorious day. Sadly, it's a glorious day where many of us have to stay at home. So please stay safe, and we wish you could be here with us this morning, but it is what it is at the moment. There's a few announcements with things that are happening in and around our church. Not many announcements, but just a couple, and hopefully they're going to come up on the screen for you to see. We're going to continue. This is our third and final week in the Be the Church series, and we're looking at peculiar service this morning as we've been thinking about a peculiar God. That's not a bad God, but a maybe not to be expected God. We've been looking at last week unity and reconciliation, and today we're looking at, in particular, service and what it is that Jesus has taught us about serving each other and how it is that we do that. Also, just in regards to that, the picture that is behind the image on the Be the Church artwork is, once again, just a reminder, the picture of the woman who had internal bleeding for 12 years, who reached out and touched the hem of Jesus' garment and was healed. We've been thinking about how it is that we as the church are really sort of coming together and going out into the world as a community of people who have been touched by Jesus, had a conversation with Jesus, and been changed as a result. And I hope today, as well as the last 2 weeks, you'll really see that theme coming through, that we're the church because of what Jesus has done in us. That is how it is that we're the church. So we're going to be thinking about that. And last week I mentioned if you wanted to make a contribution to the chat, you could do that. A few things about that. First of all, you need to find the chat function. If you're able to look for the chat function and open that in YouTube, you're then able to contribute. If you're worried about things that you say might be up there forever, they're only there for this live stream, and then the chat is removed. So you can go to that. And if you would like to, what I was hoping you might share with us this morning is to share in the chat a verse that points to how God has served us that has personally impacted you. So a verse about how God has served us, humanity, his people, how he may have served you personally, that has impacted you personally. So if you'd like to share that, I'm going to mention that in the sermon as well, but that would be awesome if you'd like to do that. It's an opportunity to encourage each other and to somehow be together, even though we're not together in the same room. As we begin this morning, I just want to highlight the fact, firstly, that we have quite a selection of hymns. We've got community hymn singing this morning, and so we're going to be singing various hymns this morning, 7 in total. So I hope you enjoy that from the comfort of your home this morning, and I hope that you have the opportunity to sing loudly where you are. Just with regards to... Sorry, I'm a little bit lost. Now I've got it. Yep. Wanted to start with just one verse this morning as a call to worship from John 19:30. It's the words of our Lord Jesus Christ as he hung on the cross. It says, when he had received the drink, Jesus said, "It is finished." And with that, he bowed his head and gave up his spirit. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for Jesus Christ and his great gift to us. We recognize that he is not simply the crucified Jesus, but he is also the risen Lord. We thank you that his spirit now lives in us and dwells in us. We pray, Heavenly Father, that this time, this morning, would be a great time to be reminded that we are your children, bought at the cost and the price of your own Son. And that as such, people who have been saved, you have a role for us to play in this fallen world, that we might be your hands, your feet, indeed your body. We pray, Heavenly Father, we might be encouraged in that this morning. Not to try and do things in our own strength, but in the strength of the Lord Jesus Christ, who lives and dwells within us, in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, our first hymn this morning is 244. I love the words of this hymn. "Look, you saints, the sight is glorious. See the man of sorrows now from the fight returned victorious."
Heavenly Father, we have come here today to worship you, the source of all love and grace, creator and sustainer of the universe. Let us put out of our minds all cares and worries of the week and those things that make us anxious and afraid, so that with joyful hearts we can bring to you our praise and thanks. Lord, we lift up our hearts to you in love and adoration. We praise you for your greatness. You are the great and mighty King, and all glory belongs to you. Words cannot describe how awesome you are. You are the creator of heaven and earth, and everything belongs to you. We thank you for the coming of Jesus Christ into our world, for the new teachings he brought that changed the old order, teachings that have come down across the ages to our own time to challenge our actions and beliefs. We thank you for his death and resurrection and the promise of eternal life. We thank you for our friends and family and all the joy and laughter we share with them. And as we worship you, O Lord, we are conscious of the many ways we have failed you. Forgive us the times that we have been filled with anger and bitterness. Forgive us the times when we've been too concerned about money and material possessions. Forgive us for those secret things for which we are ashamed. Forgive us our inability to recognize your presence. Forgive us our deafness to your teachings. Forgive us our reluctance to follow your lead. And forgive us when you want to send us out, but we refuse to go. Help us to live in unity with those around us. And in this time of great change and challenge, help us to be generous in our dealings with others, respect other points of view, and using them to enlarge our vision. These things we pray with the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen.
Today's Bible's reading is at Philippians chapter 2, verses 1 to 11, imitating Christ's humility. Therefore, if you have any encouragement from being united with Christ, if any comfort from his love, if any common sharing in the Spirit, if any tenderness and compassion, then make my joy complete by being like-minded, having the same love, being one in spirit, and of one mind. Do nothing out of selfish ambitions or vain conceit. Rather, in humility value others above yourselves, not looking to your own interests, but each of you to the interests of the others. In your relationship with one another, having the same mindset as Christ Jesus, who, being in very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be used to his own advantage. Rather, he made himself nothing by taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness. And being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God exalted him to the highest place and gave him the name that is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow, in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue acknowledge that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of the Father. Today's Bible's reading is at Philippians chapter 2, verses 1 to 11, imitating Christ's humility. Therefore, okay, if you have any encouragement from being united with Christ, if any comfort from his love,
we're sing three hymns,
if any common
Majesty,
sharing...
Blessed is the man, and Jesus, a joy of loving hearts.
Majesty, Jesus who died. greatest at man.
What is daylight by day and night
is the law of God Almighty. He is like a tree that flourishes, being planted by the water. Blessed is that man. He will bring forth fruit, his leaf will wither not.
For in good he does, he prospers. Blessed is that man.
For his delight by day not walk in the counsel of the ungodly. Blessed is that man.
Jesus, the joy of loving hearts, true source of life and light of men, from the best things that art imparts, return unveiled to you again. Our restless spirits long for you, whichever
we present to God our prayer of thanksgiving and intercession. Please join me in prayer. O Lord, we do thank you that even if we are not physically together, we are one in spirit and we are together here in your presence. For that is the way you have created us to be in union with yourself. We thank you for the glorious redemption by which you have brought each of us on eagle's wings to yourself and presented each of us to yourself as a glorious sacrifice. We thank you that this is your will and you have spelt it out to us clearly through the scriptures. We thank you for your wonderful plans based on your infinite wisdom for our welfare, not to hurt us, but for our blessing and our flourishing. Thank you for the way that our hardship brings us discipline and brings us hope, and that will never disappoint because it is hope based in you alone. Heavenly Father, to this end we pray that you would be with each of us, especially be with those who are in our congregation and those who we know who are sick, who are grieving, who are suffering, who are in pain. Grant them your grace and your peace. We pray for your blessing on everyone who works in our church offices, for your servants, our minister, and for all the staff at this church and who produce the services. Bless their work and their efforts on our behalf. Lord, commit them to you and let them know that nothing they do is unappreciated. And we pray, Lord, that you would preserve our fellowship, keep each of us in each other's hearts and minds. Help us to continue to build each other up and encourage each other through phone calls and emails and texts. Heavenly Father, as we cannot be together physically, make sure that we are together spiritually. We pray, Heavenly Father, for this state and the state of Victoria, as we pray that we would be able to work together. And we commit to you our leaders, we commit to you the medical professionals, strengthen and encourage them to stop the spread of the virus and to lead us through this time of hardship. We pray to you and give thanks to you for the links our church has with Indonesia. We pray therefore that you would have mercy on that country, strengthen the hearts of the medical workers there and the government there, and turn that virus back on itself, Lord, so that people would live. Have mercy on the grieving and the suffering. We thank you for the blessing of our links from this church to Burma. Please bless Go Chin's family as they grieve the death of Go Chin's brother. Please bring healing to the rest of his family who are also suffering with the Delta variant. Please avoid a humanitarian crisis and supply them with enough food and potable water and medical supplies. And please bless their political situation in that country so that there would be peace and fairness and justice in the government and the release of political prisoners. Heavenly Father, we do want to commit ourselves into your hands now. We pray all of these things in Jesus Christ's name and for his sake. Amen.
I'll need my notes. Well, we're six hymns down, only one to go, so we're doing very well. Thanks, Richard and Alison. You have well and truly earned your money this morning, so thank you for blessing us with your voices. Also, thank you to Sue and Betty and Jan, who were the ones who we sang in the community hymn singing, the hymns that they had chosen. But now we're going to turn to Philippians 2, 1 to 11. We're going to continue to think about a living kingdom, and in particular how we as the church are the living kingdom, and this idea of peculiar service that I introduced earlier during the announcements. Once again, if you'd like to, I've noticed some people have already shared in the chat, but please, if you'd like to, find the chat function. Remember, the chat does not continue after today. It is lost, and so we do encourage you to be polite and nice and encouraging what you write, but just to know that it's not going to be held against you for all time. To share in the chat a verse that reminds you of how God has served humanity that has impacted you personally. If you'd like to do that, because that is what today is all about. It is actually how God has served us. Before we look at how God has served us, we probably need to highlight the problem that the reality that as human beings in a fallen, broken world, we don't naturally serve others. That's not God's nature. Our nature is our broken, fallen nature is that we often struggle to serve others. And my first point this morning is that the self served. Interesting turn of phrase, the self served. The idea that is what often our main aim is, to serve ourself. James Bryan Smith, who I've quoted through this from his book Good and Beautiful Community, which is about the church, he says this. He once conducted some research and he asked a pastor, if the life of discipleship to Jesus really takes root in a community of people, particularly in a local church, how would you know if it was really beginning to make a difference? What's it look like when Jesus makes a difference in a local church is the question. And without hesitation, this pastor replied, in committee meetings. Now, Presbyterians love committees. So this, I assume, is relevant to us as Presbyterians. James Bryan Smith actually goes on to say, my first response was to chuckle because I know from many years on church committees just how discouraging they can be and how badly people can behave. There is a reason, I guess, or a direction that James Bryan Smith is taking us with this, but just for a moment, I have talked about Joseph Grenier and his book Crucial Conversations before. And he talks about crucial conversations are conversations where there's high stakes, there's high emotions, and there are opposing views. High stakes, high emotions, opposing views. Those three things are the recipe for crucial conversations. And committee meetings are loaded with crucial conversations. There's high stakes. There's things that people really want. That's why they're on the committee. I mean, who volunteers to be on a committee if you don't want something out of it? And then there's high emotions. Sometimes, especially in a church environment, there can be a lot of passion about the things that are being discussed. And then the thing that really sets those two things in play in a way that can be cause it to be a crucial conversation is that there are opposing views. There are opposing views that are held passionately about important things. Well, he goes on to say this, and so this is James Bryan Smith, just after those two quotes says this. He says, the problem comes when the most important consideration, the dominant desire, and the main focus of the community is its own success. Communities can become so focused on themselves that they lose their souls. The community no longer exists to fulfill its original mission, but simply to stay alive. And I've got to say that there's a huge difference in committee meetings between churches that are struggling to survive and are indeed now looking to their own survival, as opposed to committees for churches that are alive and they are growing and they are healthy. Suddenly, when we start to not see things as being abundant, resources abundant, but we see instead a scarcity, we can start to get overly occupied on just survival. And in the church, that shouldn't be our problem. That shouldn't be our worry. We believe in a God who provides for our needs. And he is the one who said he will build his church. But can you see the problem that James Bryan Smith is highlighting? This idea that you become so obsessed or just simply interested in your own success as a community, and he also makes it clear this is true for individuals as well, that you become focused on yourself so much that you lose your soul, and how it is that individuals can lose their souls. But he also highlights the fact that churches, communities have a soul as well, and you start to lose that because you have sold out for the original reason why you came to be. When you are the end in yourself, there is nothing bigger than you can live for. I want to ask a question for us to consider right now this morning. How would you feel about Jesus if he had saved himself? How would you feel about Jesus if he had saved himself? The Lord knows that he got told many, many times, save yourself. Come down off the cross, if indeed you are who you say you are. There's no doubt we would believe that we followed a powerful Jesus. Look, he saved himself. We can't save ourselves, he saved himself. He's worth following. But in not saving himself, Jesus does something that's so much more. He gives himself for you and for me. If Jesus had saved himself, I'm sorry, but my view of Jesus would be less. I love the fact that he's powerful. I love the fact that he could raise himself from the dead. I love the fact that he gave himself for me. And he gave himself for me before I even knew him. He gave himself for me when I was his enemy. He gave himself for me when I have willfully gone my own way. The self serve themselves. That is what it is to be selfish. But Jesus did not save himself. And yet if you look at the time of Jesus, this is exactly, so this quote that I got from James Bryan Smith, this idea that a community exists to fulfill its, no longer to fulfill its original mission, but simply to stay alive. This is what the religious leaders were doing in the time of Jesus. This is a quote from John 11 when they're talking about Jesus. They say, what are we accomplishing? They asked. Here is this man, they're talking about Jesus, performing many signs, which should tell them he's somebody they should be thinking, paying attention and even thinking about following. He says, if we let him go on like this, everyone will believe in him, and then the Romans will come and take away our temple and our nation. Listen to their arrogance. Our temple. Sorry, but this is God's temple, and it is God's nation. Even before the time of Jesus, this idea, this ridiculousness of we will sell ourselves out for something less than we should, something short of who we actually are, was something the Israelites did as they came out of Egypt, didn't they? Do you remember this, what they said to Moses? Was it because there were no graves in Egypt that you brought us to the desert to die? What have you done to us by bringing us out of Egypt? Didn't we say to you in Egypt, leave us alone, let us serve the Egyptians? It would have been better for us to serve the Egyptians than to die in the desert. They've forgotten something, haven't they? They believe in a God who chose them as a people, not to serve Egyptians, but to be free. But oh no. No, no, no. They'd much rather sell out that idea. They just want to survive. They don't care if they have to serve the Egyptians. They would rather do that. James Bryan Smith highlights this reality. This reality that there is a false narrative, and I talked about core narratives last weekend, especially the week before. The idea that there's a core narrative that you choose to follow that will indeed impact how you behave. Well, there is a false narrative going on, and that is that our needs matter the most. Our needs matter the most. And we've all heard that God serves those, looks up, serves those who serve themselves. That was indeed not written by a Christian. Not even somebody who believes in the God of the Bible. It's certainly not in the Bible. That's actually not the God that we believe in at all. We believe in a God who serves those who cannot serve themselves. So there's this false narrative, our needs matter the most. You might remember Martin Buber, a Jewish philosopher that I referred to, who talked about the I, thou, and the I, it. The I, it could be summed up with our needs matter most, and every other person that we encounter is not a person with their own needs, but they're an it that we can use for our needs. So this leads us to the second point, and that is the peculiar serve. Who are the peculiar? You and I are. We are the ones who follow a peculiar God. And James Bryan Smith would say that there is a true narrative that we could choose to make our core narrative to live by, and that is that others' needs matter the most. It is the I-thou, where we look at other people as a human being made in God's image. They hurt as we hurt. They love as we love. They feel indeed as we do. And we have been put here not to serve ourselves, but to serve others. So let's look at this passage now that we're already a third of the way into the talk, verses 3-4. It says, in humility, value others above yourselves, not looking to your own interests, but each of you to the interests of others. So Paul is writing to the Philippians. He's making it crystal clear, and I think I've alluded to the fact before that humility here in verse 3 of Philippians is the first time that word humility is used in the history of literature in a positive light. And it was Jesus who made it possible for it to be used in a positive light. The idea of humility, that you set your power aside for the good of others. That was the definition that this word translated as humility was used, the way it was understood in the time of Paul. This is a good thing. In humility, value others above yourselves. It's a new way of thinking that Jesus brings to this world. And so we follow this peculiar Saviour. Paul here is quite peculiar. Like I said, this is the first time in written literature, the history of written literature, that this word is used in this way. It's a peculiar, surprising, not normal way of using this word. And so those who follow Jesus are to be like Jesus. If I could take you to John 13, this is sort of just picking out 3 points from John 13, 2-5, and I hope you appreciate the 3 points that I've picked out here, because if you just were to read John 13, 2-5, you might miss these 3 points. The evening meal was in progress, okay? We're in the middle of a meal here. Jesus puts down his food. Indeed, if he had a plate, pushed the plate to one side. The evening meal was in progress. Jesus interrupts what's happening. Now just for a second, think on this. Jesus knew that the Father had put all things under his power. I'll repeat that. Jesus knew that the Father had put all things under his power. There was nobody greater than Jesus at this point. There was no power more powerful. There was no authority greater. Jesus is it. What would you do if you were it for a minute? What would you do if you had all power and authority? And it says, and Jesus began to wash the feet of his disciples. Can you see what we're dealing with here? This isn't that Jesus was forced to serve. Jesus chose to serve, even though he had no reason to serve, no need to serve. Mid-meal, the all-powerful washes feet. It's scandalous. It's crazy. It really does add a new dimension to the idea of humility, of setting aside one's power. And the more power you have, the harder it is to set aside, no doubt. Jesus has all power. He sets it aside so that he could serve. And he does this even to death. These are the words that I opened the service with this morning. When he had received the drink, Jesus said, "It is finished." And with that, he bowed his head and gave up his spirit. So what does this mean for us who follow this servant king? The ones who follow this peculiar server. Well, I hope you, if you remember last week, this won't be lost on you, and that is the simple reality that the served serve. The served serve. Now, I do want to highlight, I'm not sure if I nuanced this well enough last week at points. I don't mean that everybody who has ever served serves. Mothers and fathers here know that Just because you've served your child since the day they popped out doesn't mean that when they're 15 they will serve you at every turn. It doesn't work that way. But for us who serve the risen Lord Jesus, who gave his life for us, we should serve. And so that is why Paul says in Philippians, therefore, if you have any encouragement from being united with Christ, if any comfort from his love, if any common sharing in the Spirit, if any tenderness and compassion. Now, all of that, I used to read that and I used to get a bit jumbled through that. I used to think, okay, he's talking about things to do, encourage you from being united with Christ. And so that's bringing a community of believers into that as well. And the, you know, common sharing in the Spirit, that means us as a group. Any tenderness and compassion, that's how I feel about my brothers and sisters. But no, that's not actually it. This is all to do with me and Jesus, just me and Jesus, just you and Jesus that Paul is encouraging us with here. He says, therefore, if you have any encouragement from being united with Christ, that's just you and Jesus, it's just me and Jesus. If that connection means anything, if you have got any comfort from his love, if any common sharing in the Spirit, his Spirit, connected to you, if any tenderness and compassion as a result of Christ being connected to you, then make my joy complete by being like-minded to Christ. Not like-minded to him, Paul, though it won't be different-minded to him, but like-minded to Christ, having the same love of Paul. No, not Paul's love, of Jesus's love. Philippians, this passage is just this, I love this passage. It just points to Jesus and says, if you've got any connection to him, if what he's done on the cross means anything to you. And that's the foundation for us as this peculiar community who serves and follows this peculiar king. In John 13, Jesus, as I've alluded to, washes the feet of the disciples. Even though he realizes the Father has given him all power, he washes their feet. But he says something, he highlights to them what it is that he has done in verses 15 and 17. He says, I've set you an example that you should do as I have done for you. This is what Paul's talking about. He's done something intimate. He served them in a way that was unique and surprising and scandalous. And he says, now that you know these things, you will be blessed if you do them. The served are to serve. They don't always, but they will be blessed if they do. Because if they do, Paul would say his joy will be made complete. The purpose for Christ coming is seen in completion, and we're not glorified. Indeed, Christ is glorified because our serving becomes an extension of his grace working in us and through us. I want to take you to the end of John 21, and I go here often, I know. It's one of my favorite little parts of Scripture, where Jesus comes to Peter, and they have breakfast by the shores of the lake. They've been out all night fishing because Jesus had died, and it's actually the risen Jesus that they meet on the beach. And Jesus asks Simon three times the same question. And it says the third time in verse 17, Jesus said to him, Simon, son of John, do you love me? And Peter gets upset with that. But then he says, Lord, you know all things. You know that I love you. And so what Jesus is alluding to here is what Paul is alluding to. You know, if there's any connection here, Peter, Jesus is saying, if there's some of my spirit dwelling in your spirit in some way, if the fact that I have died for you, Peter, means anything, if my love for you means anything, then it's not enough that you just say you love me. It's important, Peter, that the served serve. And so he says, feed my sheep. Some people want to reduce this to, you know, go and tell the gospel. Well, that can be a part of it, no doubt. But I think what Jesus is calling Peter into is so much more. He's saying, wash their feet. He's saying, Peter, the power that you have, put it to one side. Jesus wants us to serve each other, to feed the sheep. And so in conclusion, there was a passage that I gave last week as we looked at unity and reconciliation. I can't help but think that this idea of service has a part to play in reconciliation and unity. And so in 2 Corinthians 5, 17 to 19, we have this: therefore, if anyone is in Christ, the new creation has come. The old has gone, the new is here. See, hear what Paul is saying? You are a new person now. You're somebody who's been served. And he says, all of this is from God, who reconciled us to himself through Christ and gave us the ministry of reconciliation. I mentioned last week, I love that, ministry of reconciliation. That God was reconciling the world to himself in Christ, not counting people's sins against them. Instead, he came and served us, sinful as we are. And he has committed to us the message of reconciliation. Those who have been reconciled will reconcile. Those who have been served will serve. And there's a strong connection between the two. So what does this ministry of reconciliation, this ministry of service, look like? Well, I want to give you some examples, and they're by no means exhaustive. No means am I saying you should do these. And if you do them, God will be pleased with you. God is already pleased with you and has already served you and loves you. And if any of these spur you on to do something similar or what have you, that was great. But let's start some things that you could do at home. Ask your spouse, housemate, family member, whoever it might be that you share residence with, how they are going, and really listen. I think the key to that one is really listen. Often we don't do that. So carve out some time. Build some margins so that you're able to do that and to be able to sit without looking at your watch to see the time. If you have children at home, give them the honour of choosing how to spend one evening this week as a family. What is it that you would like to do this evening? Because we as a family, we're going to honour you by doing what it is that you might like to do. That is a little limited in this current lockdown period. For work, visit a co-worker. Ask how you might help them. That's right. Actually, ask a co-worker how you might help them. It might actually mean that you have more work to do. I recognize that. To continue at work, make a hot beverage for others. Some of these come from James Bryan Smith. I think he had a tea or a coffee. I just wanted to go hot beverage for others, or bring some treats, or clean up the kitchen area. I know that for here, very always appreciate it when the kitchen area is cleaned up, and I endeavour to do that myself sometimes, but that's one area that in a workplace can become a real sticking point. It's a great opportunity if somebody is willing to serve in that area. It can make a huge impact. We don't do these things for impact. We do these things because we want to serve. At church, park further away from the church building, leaving space for others. That is obviously something that those of us who are able-bodied and able to walk further are able to do. I'm not suggesting other people should be doing that. I love this one: arrive early and sit up the front. James Bryan Smith actually says, sit up the front or some other place where people do not like to sit. But I think he's probably picked us as Presbyterians quite accurately. We don't like sitting down the front. Offer to do some chores in and around the church, whatever that might be. If we go out into the world, when driving, look out for opportunities to let people in ahead of you. I don't know about you, but sometimes I find myself scanning to see who might want to get in so I can make sure that I don't let them in. It's taking the opposite approach to that. When shopping, allow others to cut ahead of you in line. Some of these might go, yep, do that already. That's all right. Some of these might be very, very difficult for you. Some of these for me are very difficult. Some of them are not a problem at all. The idea is being challenged about where the ones are that are difficult. This one I like that he put in as well, and he was quite challenging about this in his book, and that is to pray for other local churches. Sometimes we get the sense that we as a church are, and this is going all the way back to the beginning in that example of the committee, that as a church, to pray for the success and the flourishing of other local churches is to pray for our own demise. There's only so many people going to churches in our local area. If we pray for them to grow, then surely we're not going to. And yet we're on the same team. We have an opportunity to bless and honour our brothers and sisters in our local area by praying for them. Encourage others in the chat, if you're on the chat right now, or if you can get to the chat function on the live stream, you have the opportunity right now to encourage others and to serve others in that way. And of course, if you are on a committee in our church, then the very next committee meeting, you have the opportunity to approach it in a way that is not, am I just here to get what I would like, my agenda met? Or am I here to use, to set aside my power for the benefit of others? Now, I give you those three slides with a whole lot of different examples very, very cautiously. There's a part of me that doesn't want to do that. There's a part of me that wants to give you a picture of what simple service looks like. There's also a part of me that doesn't want you to think that if you do those things, then that was the main aim of the talk. It's not. The main aim and purpose of this talk is to say there's a foundation that we can build our lives on that means these things flow naturally from who we are. And so I want to go to verses 6 and 8 of our reading, 6 to 8, where it says that Jesus Christ, who being in very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be used in his own advantage. Rather, he made himself nothing by taking the very nature of a servant. He humbled himself by becoming obedient to death, even death on a cross. This is the foundation. This is the most important thing. This is what we build our lives on and around. A God, a Saviour, a Redeemer, a Friend, who loves us so much that he has set aside his power to serve us. I'm always struck when I read those verses and the bit where it says, did not consider equality with God something to be used to his own advantage, or some versions have something to be grasped. If we go all the way back to Genesis, to the fall, we would see that this is the thing that underlies the behavior of Adam and Eve. When they saw the fruit made them like God, they decided to eat it. They, the created, saw equality with the Creator as something that they could grasp, use for their own advantage. We have an amazing God, don't we? After doing that, he looks down at us and says, I'm not going to consider my place as God as something to use for my own advantage. Instead, I'm going to come and save you and give of myself. I'm going to humble myself, become obedient to death, even death on a cross. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your Son, Jesus Christ. We thank you that even when he knew he had been given all power, he chose to serve. I just pray, Lord, that you would work in our hearts, that we would have a sense of your love and connection to your Spirit, that we might indeed be able to make Paul's joy complete, that we might be so changed by you that we become people who just naturally serve. I want to thank you, Lord, for Macquarie Chapel Presbyterian Church and for the people who do serve. So freely. Yeah. But I also pray, Lord, that you would help us to grow in that. Lord, help it to be something that flows out of what it is that you are doing in our hearts. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, just as Richard and Alison come up for our last hymn, which is At the Name of Jesus, Every Knee Shall Bow. Just a reminder with regards to giving. If you do have envelopes that you would like picked up, if you are unable to give via online giving, then please let us know about that. Let's sing together, At the Name of Jesus, Every Knee Shall Bow.
watch to sight all the angel faces, all the host of light.
Thrones and all dominions stand upon their way, all the heavenly orders in the grand array. Humbled for a season to receive a name from the lips of sinners unto whom he came.
Faithfully he bore it, spotless to the last, brought it back victorious when from death he passed. Name him, brothers, name him, with love strong as death, but with awe and wonder, and with bated breath.
Awesome hymn for us to finish our time together this morning. I hope it's been a blessing for you. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Amen.